unlocking the keys to success of China's most dynamic cities.
Changsha, a city where human activities can be traced back to Paleolithic age, a city where urban construction started some 2,000 years ago. Changsha, a city with booming economy anchored by pillar industries such as heavy machinery, transportation and entertainment.
And a city of vibrant culture where age-old traditions, hit TV shows, delicious food and modern living collide into one.
We meet with locals, policymakers and entrepreneurs.
We visit factories, historical sites, street food booths, and ecological farms.
All these only on CGTN.
At the Yuelu Academy. This is one of four ancient Chinese academies and really a higher center of learning. This place has been training generation after generation of intellectuals, of scholars, of thought leaders. It was built in the year 976 AD, so in the early Song Dynasty. And this place is still training students, still a higher center of learning, training the next generation of thought leaders. But we are here today to talk about the future development of Changsha from a youth perspective and just get an overall sense of the city and where it's going, its transformation process. And we've got, of course, a fantastic panel of guests joining us to talk about all of this. So let me introduce them. Real quick, we have Professor Wei Ping, who is the Associate Dean of Central South University right here in Changsha. We have Peter Joseph Kuhn, who is a co-owner, founder of CrossFit Aftershock, a competitive fitness athlete. You're also a musician and an MBA student, so pretty much a Renaissance man.
Thank
Wen Wu Shuangquan in terms of martial prowess, as well as scholastic excellence. So welcome, Peter.
Thank you.
We have Dr. Zhang Liyao, who is Chief of Department of Critical Care Medicine at Xiangya Hospital. Dr. Zhang, welcome. And then we have Yu Yi, who is a postgraduate student of foreign linguistics and applied linguistics at Hunan University. Mm-hmm. Quite an impressive CV, I would say, as well. So welcome to all of you. So we are here to discover the changes that we saw in Changsha over the past few decades, past few years, and then perhaps where this city is going, and also the secret recipe, the secret sauce of Changsha's success. Right, because our Rising Star City special series is all about uncovering the development success of these Chinese cities that perhaps may be on the radar of the international community, but should be. Right, Changsha's GDP over 1 trillion yuan already back in 2017. This is a major city here in central China. So my first question to all of you, and the same question, is why is Changsha such a happy city? Because this city is one of the top 10 happiest cities in the country now for 13 years in a row. As of 2020. So, Professor Wei, let me start with you first. Why do you think this is such a happy city?
I would like to use three colors to describe this city. The first color is unexpected. It's red color. It's revolution. Because the city is not as the cradle of revolution and the great man hometown. It was the learning, working, and living place for many big figure and famous Mao and Qu Yuan and also Liu Shaoqi, etc. The second color is what I would call the orange color, because it is the creative center of TV shows and entertainment arts. So we know the famous, the logo of a famous Mango TV is orange color.
Yeah.
We also have a good place, it's called Orange Island. So I think the color indicating the energetic and the dynamic.
Yeah.
So that's the second color. The third color, I would say, is a green color. So the integrated zone of the Changzhutan is the first in the country to propose the idea of two-oriented society, which in detail is called the resource-saving and environmental-friendly society. So since the 2007, And the area has built up a national pilot to develop economy towards sustainable and recycling community and society.
Yeah.
So I think those efforts make the city as beautiful as it is right now. So this is what I see the Changsha, and it's successful.
Red, orange, green defines Changsha.
Yeah, three colors.
Yeah, yeah.
Red, orange, and green.
And I just feel like our viewers, I wish they could see the environment that we are in right now, because the Yuelu Academy, Hunan University, where we are right now, surrounded by green, the entire city it is tremendously green, very livable, a lot of innovative green spaces. So really, I think we are seeing Changsha developing more and more green, more and more environmentally friendly. Peter, what are your thoughts? Why is the city such a happy city, and are you happy?
I'm happy as a clam, man.
Yeah.
I think that Changsha is a happy city because it's a lot of fun,
yeah.
Especially for anyone from 13, or anyone below 60, let's just say.
Okay.
There's a lot of things for everyone to do, like ranging from all different ages. There's a lot of restaurants, good food, good culture, a lot of things that you can learn, especially as a foreigner, for me. I think that Changsha is a happy city because it's very affordable, of course, and convenient, okay?
Yeah.
So that's pretty simple right there. I think in terms of transportation, I think that adds a lot to people's daily stress. And I think with the addition of the fifth line, mm-hmm. subway line, right?
Subway line. Mm-hmm.
I think it's a lot easier to get places around here.
Yeah. I mean, booming nighttime economy as well. We're going to talk about that in a second. It's what I want to ask you guys next when it comes to just describing the nightlife in this city. I haven't experienced it myself yet, but that probably on my radar sometime tonight. Looking forward to that. So, Dr. John, what do you think? Why is the city so happy?
Actually, the Changsha city is a happiness because the first they had a cheap, a relative cheap house price.
Mm-hmm.
When you graduate from the university, for the young people, you can easy to find you love the house, but you can afford it. I think it may be very hard to in the Beijing or Shanghai or Guangzhou.
In these larger cities,
and the second, maybe it have the delicious food. I think that you know you're very famous food such as cha yan yue shi, wen he you.
That's a milk tea, a local milk tea brand.
It's a local tea.
Yeah.
It's just in Hunan province,
and Hunan.
Changsha is the main have this shopping. So when you want to do the Chayan, you must to come to Changsha and then land up the long team. But we can stay in home to taste it. So the third maybe have the convenience, the traffic, because the Changsha is the middle of the China, and you can arrive all around the China city provision, maybe just 2 hours is okay. And the last maybe it have the good opportunity to the career development. Such as I'm a doctor, I graduated from the Xiangya University, but the Xiangya Hospital is the top level in the China. And we just have that for the cheap house lines price, and have the chance to have the delicious food, and also have the good opportunity, the prospect for the career development. So I think it's a very happiness.
I mean, affordability, good food, these two things combined together, convenience when it comes to transportation as well. Mm-hmm. And look, in terms of geography, Changsha located to so many other economic clusters as well. To your west, the Chongqing, Chengdu mega cluster, right to your south, you got the Greater Bay Area with Shenzhen, Guangzhou, Hong Kong, Macau, all in that area. And Wuhan, of course, also not very far away. So a very convenient location. And that's why I think it's got a very bright future in terms of development as well. I want to talk about housing prices in just a second, but I want to get Yuyi's thoughts in terms of why you think this is a very happy city as a student. And you're from Changsha as well,
Yeah, as a local, I feel lucky to live in Changsha. And I love Changsha, and I think the city is attractive to young people to live and work in.
Mm.
The highest happiness index roots in Changsha. First, Changsha owns completed urban infrastructure. A comprehensive transport network makes life work and travel so easily. And Xiangya Hospital provides the best medical treatment. Yeah.
Best medical treatment. Yeah. Wow, that's a very strong endorsement. Okay.
Yeah,
all right.
The
There's got to be a reason. We're going to ask Dr. Zhang why, right, in a second, why this is such a good hospital.
Yeah,
the history
yeah.
is very interesting, so stay tuned for that.
Yeah. Yeah. And the four famous senior high school supply top education.
Mm.
Yeah. Business is prosperous and shopping is convenient.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, 230,000 yeah. new businesses started. In Changsha last year is the number that I saw. It's a very vibrant private
right.
sector economy mm-hmm. as well. Yeah.
Mm, yeah. And second, Changsha is full of diverse food and entertainment places.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here we go again. Food.
Entertainment. Okay, yeah. yeah. It's important. Yeah.
yeah.
Crayfish and stinky tofu, fried pork with chili, rice noodles,
yeah.
and the popular milk tea, 茶颜悦色.
Yeah.
yeah are popular among young people and all the citizens.
Yeah.
Over 120 parks, game rooms, bars, and live houses are good places for citizens to
yeah.
go after work. Yeah.
Okay, so which brings me to the point of the nighttime economy. I mean, this is sort of almost a calling card for Changsha as well, sort of a defining feature of the city, the nighttime economy. It contributes a lot towards consumption. And I'm wondering if this is just a Changsha thing, a Changsha specific thing, the nighttime economy, and perhaps why? I mean, is it because it's too hot during the daytime and that's why so many consumers want to go out at the nighttime? Or, but I see a lot of people in malls as well during the nighttime,
yeah.
also, in addition to the busy market streets. So what do you think? Why is the nighttime economy so big here?
In my view, I think it is strongly linked with the Changsha's attitude towards life.
Mm.
So relax the lifestyle and also the enjoying their life. So
yeah.
here, I think locals have some very friendly and accommodating environment about the night economy. So that's very important, yeah.
So mindset, you think, is very important. And Peter, I'm sure you've really enjoyed the nightlife here in Changsha as well. What do
Absolutely.
You think?
Absolutely, I,
mean, give
I
us
still
some,
am enjoying it.
Give us some tips. So if you come to Changsha, what are some places that you gotta go when you wanna enjoy the nightlife? Some market streets, malls?
That is a good question. There's too many. Right?
There's too many.
Yeah.
Wait,
first
of all, give us your take in terms of why the night economy is so successful here. I mean, this is a distinct consumption trend, how consumers spend their time and money here in this city.
Okay, well,
yeah.
let's just take Jiefangxilu,
yeah.
for
yeah.
example.
And
yes.
Okay.
Nan
Look at that
Ko.
Smile on your face when you're talking about...
No,
that's
I
good.
I haven't go to the bar.
She's a good girl.
okay.
well, okay, so for example, Jiefangxilu mm-hmm. and Nan Man Ko or Hualongshi are like, after 9 p.m., it's like...
That's when the action starts.
That's when the action
after
starts.
After 9 p.m., yeah.
There are like... hundreds of bars on just like one street.
Mm.
And your options are literally endless.
Okay.
And if one place is packed, you can go another place.
Okay.
And after people go to the club or bars, they can get some ye xiao, get some midnight snacks or some barbecue.
Yeah.
And it's just overall a fun experience, especially for the younger generation, I think. I think it's because there are so many colleges in Changsha. So that definitely attracts a lot of young people. So there's the possibilities are limitless
yeah.
for young people.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what time is it right now? This is 11 a.m.
Yeah.
In the morning. So I guess I'm really counting down the minutes to when I can enjoy Changsha's nightlife tonight. But Dr. Zhang, I mean, I want to get your take on Changsha's nighttime economy. I mean, as a doctor, I mean, from the medical field, is this really healthy for the city? I mean, what do you think?
The most of the time I will stay in the hospital.
You will stay in the
so,
hold on, let me interrupt you 1 second. From what I've heard, the nighttime consumers, they stay out until 3 to 4 a.m. in the morning,
mm-hmm.
right? So confirm that for me, that's true, right? So nighttime consumption in the city goes all the way to 3 to 4 a.m. in the morning, yeah.
I go to the hospital from the home to maybe the 7 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
the morning. But because that's my children is now learning in the school, it's a bit far from my hospital.
Yeah.
after he's graduated, I will go to the near the hospital, even just to the 20 minutes to the go to the to go to the hospital. It's just 10 minutes to walking to the hospital. It's my home to my working,
working
place.
Okay.
So I think it's very convenient. So Changsha is very convenient for us because you can to you're willing to do anytime, anywhere, and you can go there.
It is, again, it's a mindset issue, right? People just want to enjoy life more here.
Yeah.
The pace of life, I wouldn't say the pace of life is slow. I mean, it's hustle and bustle. It's a very dynamic city. I wouldn't say the pace of life is slow, but you still have that economic dynamism that you see, and still you have that sort of enjoying life kind of mindset, right? What do you think? I mean, have you? What are your experiences of enjoying the nighttime economy in Changsha as a student? Go together? I mean, nighttime economy and your studies, are they, you got to balance that out?
I like delicious food, and I like the barbecue in the residence buildings. Yeah,
uh-huh.
It's fantastic.
Barbecue skewers in Changsha is something that you should try as well.
Barbecue stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to talk about affordability because that's another consistent theme that you've all talked about. Affordable housing is something that Changsha is also known for. And from the business school, Professor Wei, I think I have to ask you this question in terms of why do you think Changsha was able and is able still to have such affordable housing despite having such a dynamic economy? Because if your economy is doing well, the city's GDP growth outpaced that of the national average last year. If your economy is doing well, your housing prices should go up in tandem with that. But it seems like Changsha's housing prices, you can't say it didn't go up, but it's going up at a pace where it's in tandem with rising incomes as well. So, you know, what you earn every single year, you really can't afford a home in a short amount of time. So, so explain this phenomenon for us.
Okay, I mean, from my understanding, I think there are a number of reasons behind. The first reason, from what I know, is that actually the city of Changsha has started of urbanization or this kind of the new building very late stage compared to many other big cities in China. So from what I know is only since the 2000, particularly the central government and the other, say, university, they have this kind of the 工房改造, 就是这种福利分房, 一直到2000年以后才开始 才开始最终结束啊, it's very late. Actually, many other cities stop this kind of 福利分房 very early stage, so we have a very late stage. So that's reason is the demand in the market for the house is not as hard, as big as many other cities. That's the first very important reason. The second reason is very strict control by the government, by local government. So, even, I mean, after a long while, the price hasn't been rising up as much as many other cities, and the local government has already stepped in to give a very strict control, so which didn't give enough space for the local property market to go up. But according to economic theory, because we have increasing, the Changsha has enjoying the great the economic growth and emerging importance in the central part, we all actually put extra value on the property market in Changsha. So if you want to buy, you want to invest in Changsha, please come in here.
Okay, I mean, I'm thinking about this because the housing is still really affordable and you got quite a dynamic economy as well. So
I think that's the two major reasons.
And if you have the housing taken care of, that really eases the mindset of people as well. And people can spend more of their discretionary incomes to consume more in the city. Peter, I want to get to you. So you are a youth entrepreneur here in Changsha. I mean, talk to us about your story. You were born...
Well, first, I wouldn't say youth.
Okay. Young at heart.
Sure, that works.
What are you talking about? Youth entrepreneur, you know, young entrepreneur
here
in Changsha. I mean, you were born in the United States and then... you came to Changsha, what, you told me 7 years ago.
That's correct.
And then you've been here ever since. So I guess, first of all, why did you choose Changsha? And then what are sort of your experiences in starting a business here?
Okay, well, part A of that question would be because my mother is from Changsha.
Mm-hmm.
Or I could say she grew up here.
Yeah.
After my graduation, my undergrad, I didn't find any really serious career paths, so she was like, you know what, why don't you just go to Changsha and explore the city and get to know your relatives better and understand the culture and learn the language. I mean, Putonghua. I mean, learn Mandarin.
Right.
So I did that. I came and I found that China was a really great place for me, very suitable, especially Changsha at the time, 7 years ago, when there wasn't so much economic development. So it was still kind of like the Wild West, but at the same time, there's still this urban development. So that was pretty cool. After I stayed a year, my girlfriend at the time was able to secure a scholarship, a full-time scholarship at Zhonan Dashui.
Fantastic.
And Zhonan Dashui was able to give me quite generous accommodations,
to put it in a generous way.
Yes, to put that in a nice way.
Yeah.
So I stayed ever since, and that's when I started my business about 3 or 4 years ago with my current wife. Mm-hmm. And when I, to answer part B of that question, when we were starting, it was very difficult because we were in the sports industry or athletics industry. So at the time, the Zhongkao and the Gaokao Chengji was maybe not that important, right? There's, I think it was like, it wasn't that big of a part. So
Hold on. The Zhongkao and Gaokao Chengji, you said. So that's the middle school entrance exams, the high school entrance, the university entrance exams.
Correct.
Yeah, so the physical education element of those exams were not that important yet. Okay.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. So as far as producing income from the kids like 3 to 16, it was a little more difficult.
Yeah.
However, adult members that come to our gym, we're definitely getting more and more interested. However, our specific sport of like competitive fitness or weightlifting and gymnastics, stuff like that, still is very unknown, especially my gym is called CrossFit. Okay, it's a very varied mixture of different sports combined together. It's still in Changsha, people don't really know what it is, but they know that working out and eating right is good for you. So in that regard, I think the members are definitely increasing as the entire population of the city is getting to know the benefits of eating nutritiously and exercising.
So the health consciousness
is
increasing.
Correct.
And you got to do that, right? Because every single one of you has said such great food in Changsha. So you got to work out on that front. What about, Peter, in terms of the ease of doing business, in terms of starting a business? Because I know the government, the city government, wants to make it as convenient as possible. This city ranks number one. I didn't know this before I came here, but it ranks number one in central China when it comes to the business environment, 9th overall nationally. So this is a top 10 city when it comes to the ease of doing business. And I'm wondering if you really sort of experienced that yourself in terms of registration, doing business overall.
That you're going to have to ask my wife.
She took care of the registration part.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hun?
Hun is not here apparently right now. But okay, got it.
So honestly, like it wasn't that difficult. There weren't too many obstacles in starting your own business. You just have to do some paperwork and make sure things are safe and follow the rules and follow the guidelines, and then you're good to go.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Peter, do you have to get a license from government?
Yes, of course.
Because you are the foreigner doing it, do you have to get a specific license?
Of course,
because
of course.
It's June.
Yeah, okay. Of course. You have to follow the rules.
Is it easy procedure?
It's all right.
Okay.
Good. So quite an interesting experience here in Changsha.
Absolutely.
And you're going to be here, I think, for a few more years at least.
Well, we're expecting a child.
Okay.
So I think...
Well, congratulations.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
So at least... maybe 5 to 10 years.
Another 5 to 10 years in the city.
Or until I get rich.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's always a plan, until you get rich.
I'm just kidding. I think Changsha is a really, really suitable place for me.
Yeah.
So I'm probably going to stay for quite some time.
Okay. Sounds good. Fascinating experience, Peter. Dr. Zhang, I want to come to you in terms of Xiangya Hospital. This is also, in terms of historical significance, this hospital has a great story. Talk to us more about your hospital.
Yeah, it's my honor to introduce my hospital. Xiangya Hospital is co-founding, I think it may be the landmark of the international collaboration. Mm. Xiangya Hospital is co-founded by Yale University.
Co-founded with Yale,
yeah,
okay.
And the Hunan government in 1906.
1906 it was founded?
Yeah,
1906.
From last time, the Humei is an American doctor from the Yale University, and the Yan Fuqing is another excellent doctor. Is from after he graduated from the Yale University, he's a Chinese people. He returned back to the China, and together with Hu Mei to leading and set up the Xiangya Hospital. And after that, in the 1933, they together with the government. That is Tan Zhongkai. It's the governor of the Hunan government last time, and set up the Xiangya Medical School. Mm-hmm. I think it may be the first medical school set up with the U.S. And the China. It is the collaboration, the medical education.
Okay.
And from that, we know that Xiangya Hospital and Xiangya Medical School now is the top level in the China. Mm. We have the Xiangya experience, 公勇情深, 诚爱千年.
That's hard to translate, Dr. Zhang.
Yeah, I don't know how to translate.
Diligent. Diligence is part of it, okay.
Yeah. 必须求真求确,必须必专. I think just the Xiangya experience to in front of all the Xiangya people, Xiangya doctor and the nurse to together effort to make our hospitals safe to be the excellent, to peaceful, to beautiful, and also to humanity. We just talk if the patient need you to do, we want to be willing to do that. Just as in the last year, you know the COVID-19 in Wuhan.
Yeah.
And from that time in the, just after festive in the Chinese. And from the February, February 1st, that we over to set up 130 people, doctor and nurse, to go to Wuhan, Pingping, we just the Wuhan Xihe Xiyuan.
Okay.
Just the hospital to cure the intensive care patients.
So very fast response from Xiangya Hospital, sending 130 doctors to support Wuhan.
130 doctors and nurses.
Doctors and nurses, okay.
You co-founding with the 30 doctor and 100 nurse.
I see.
So that just to responsible award, we have to choose cure 157 patients, and all of the patient you can outpatient can cure well. So
yeah.
it's our honor to do that.
And I feel like the pandemic control of the city of Changsha was excellent last year. Under a month,
it really was, since
when the outbreak occurred, zero new cases is what I read. Under 2 months, no cases anymore in hospitals as well. So, Dr. Zhang, are you perhaps able to expand a little bit more in terms of Changsha's pandemic control? I mean, why was it so successful?
Yeah, so our world, I'm a critical care medicine doctor. I work in the ICU. You know, it addressed the patient to becoming to the deliverers, and he have the organ failure. He will come to our world.
Yeah.
And at that time, my teacher, he is 60 years old.
Yeah.
And that's that time he responsible for the Hunan province COVID-19 cure. And he came to organization all of the private doctors to together to the cure this kind of the patient in the Changsha. And all of the our world have the four nurse to go to the Jingyin Tan from the Wuhan. Mm. And I also have the one nurse in the San Liang. So it is all of the aspect of the we just need a way to do. We can just try our best to do that.
Okay. So I think very effective governance when it comes to pandemic control and based on what you described as well. So thank you from Xiangyang Hospital in terms of your contributions and support to Wuhan. And also to pandemic control efforts here in Changsha. And speaking of effective governance, even though you're still a student, but you are, you know, monitoring what the government is doing in terms of tracking policy initiatives you think that are applicable to you. So what do you think in terms of overall effective governance, in terms of overall policies that have been introduced by the government, that by the city government, that could apply to students and perhaps impact how you think about the future of the city? What do you think?
For fresh graduates, there will be programs and intensive or support systems for our students to start up our own company or enter the job market. Mm. Yeah. For fresh graduates who want to start up their own business, the most difficult is the lack of experience and finance. And fortunately, there is entrepreneurship subsidy policies in Changsha. Mm. The government offers rent subsidies, financial support, and startup training.
Yeah. Okay.
First, Changsha chooses 200 excellent grass startups to support financially every year. And so if fresh grads intend to start their own business, they can apply for enterprise grant for 100,000 yuan.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
And every year, in order to encourage new grads to begin their own business, Bank of Changsha spare 300 million yuan as special purpose guaranteed loans for fresh grads.
Hmm. Yeah.
And third, they can enjoy 3-year tax relief and a rent subsidy.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
And for those who enter the job market, they can also apply for rent and living allowance and social security subsidy.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. 3,000, 20,000 and 12,000 for doctor, master and bachelor respectively.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. So when you graduate, do you think, in terms of finding a job, do you think that's going to be hard in this city? I mean, first of all, do you plan to stay in Changsha, your hometown?
I plan to stay
And also, what do you think about the youth employment opportunities once you graduate? I mean, are you concerned about finding a job, or do you think it's going to be relatively easy? What do you think?
I think fresh grads can begin our work, business, and life more easily and pleasantly in Changsha, because the
housing prices are very
housing
affordable,
prices,
like we mentioned. Yes.
Yeah. Even some second or third tier cities.
Mm.
Okay.
I mean, what about talent attraction then? Talent attraction and, you know, talent retainment. Because Dr. Zhang, you've been here since 1994. As an undergrad, you came from the northeast of China, so where I'm from as well, and you made your way all the way here to Changsha, quite a distance, and you've been here since 1994, and you chose to stay here as well. So what do you think about attracting talent from different places across the country, perhaps around the world as well, and then also retaining talent? What do you think?
I think that I think when you choose the university, you just maybe a half a chance to be live in this city.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have I just to in the university, I find my lover, and I have a boyfriend, and just to stay here. And the second, we also love our hospital.
Yeah.
I love the Xiangya. Mm-hmm. So I love the Changsha city.
Yeah. But again, it's the environment that made you say. I mean, I could find my significant other here in any particular city, but if we don't like it, we can just simply move away. But you chose to stay. It's still got to be the environment, I think, that made you stay here for quite a bit. What do you think, Professor Wei, in terms of Changsha's talent attraction policies?
From my experience, I could see increasing number of the graduates actually choose to work in Changsha after graduation very recently.
Not going to some of the major cities.
Yes,
like
particularly
Beijing,
go to Shenzhen, Shanghai. More recently, increasing number.
Because it's so close to Guangzhou and Chengdu and Chongqing.
Yeah.
They can choose to go to these areas.
It is,
but they don't. They choose to stay in Changsha.
So from here, I think the more specifically, I think that's a combination of many factors.
Yeah.
Firstly, clearly is the low property price, it's affordable.
Yep.
And the second, I think it's very relaxed lifestyle here. You're enjoying life first, and others say, not really so important. So I think the third also is very creative city. You can see a lot of the, particularly as I mentioned, it's creative center for the entertainment, arts, and also the TV shows, which means the city is accommodating a new idea and a new concept and a new business model. So the market is very accommodating. I think that's very important and attractive for young people.
Yeah.
I think finally could be certainly it's a great choice of the delicious food and those entertainment activity. So all those kind of facts combining together, I think it's extremely attractive for the young people.
Yeah.
And more specifically, particularly for the university level, I also see increasing number of the people joining the Central South University. I think a part of also contributed by the university, the incentives. So very recently, university have produced a great incentives for young graduates, and particularly in terms of the generous amount of relocation package.
Mm.
So this is, might be a marketing for Central South University. In university level, offer is
300,000.
300,000, just purely is paid into your money pocket to pay for the housing to buy the property.
And also,
300,000.
Relocation
package. And also, very generous level of research startup. If it is you are studying in the engineering area, so I believe it's 50,000 to 100,000 for research startup.
So support for startups to the tune of 200,000 to 500,000 yuan.
Yes.
So 500,000 if you're in, say, the engineering fields, the STEM fields. Okay.
And the science fields, For social science, I think it's 20,000.
For social
science.
For
startup,
Okay, so for somebody like me who learned economics, I can only get 200,000, unfortunately.
You don't have to buy machine or et cetera. So actually, the social cost is lower. So this is extremely attractive for young people to come in.
Okay.
So in our hospital, the PhD after you graduate from the Xiangya Medical School, all the other medical school, you can come to our hospital. You can do, you can just give the first year to the 20,000, the 20,000,
200,000
to do the research or the other what you want to do, you can use it.
Hold on, so 200,000 grant for whatever research you want to do.
Yeah.
So just spark your creativity in whatever fields you want in the medical field, of course. Just to support your creativity, this 200,000.
That amount is on top of university funds.
On top of what the university has already given you.
Because what I mentioned is university level.
Yeah.
For at each school actually have many the top up amount for that. So it is very generous for young people.
Yeah.
Okay.
Particularly given that the property price is so low. So
many
of our friends might know, I know after 1 year they join the university, so they are able to buy a flat with more than 100 meter squares, which is unimaginable in big city like Beijing or Shanghai
or in any other big city around the world.
Cities.
It's impossible. In any other big cities around the world,
it is,
it's impossible.
Also, in our university, we are together that the student, the medical student, need to do the 8 years medical student.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the last year, we will help him to go to the abroad, such as Yale University
or
the Pittsburgh University.
Yeah.
And he can to learn in there for 2 years and to get his MD or PhD.
Mm-hmm.
And when coming up, you can just to stay in the hospital.
I see.
And what
就是他我们讲所有的费用都是大学来支出的。
Wow, okay. So scholarship paid, I guess, to study after 8 years of residency at Xiangyang Hospital. Then you can go to either University of Pittsburgh or Yale to further your studies, and that's all covered by the university.
Yeah.
All right, so that's a plug for Xiangyang Hospital as well. Yeah. Plug for Central South University. Plug for Hunan University. Health consciousness for CrossFit as well.
I'm also part of Central South University. I can vouch for what she just said.
There
very,
we go.
Very generous.
There we go.
In terms of talent acquisition.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Good.
But I have to point out it. I think it's quite important thing is that we still short of the high-end the talents. So in terms of attractiveness for Changsha, attractiveness for high-end talent is still quite limited.
I see.
So I do think the local government still have to improve a lot about this kind of attractiveness. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And speaking about the economy, Professor Wei, so perhaps we're transitioning to just a bit of a heavier topic, because this city is known for its manufacturing prowess. You have a lot of heavy industry giants here in Changsha, and the city is very focused on intelligent manufacturing, so advanced manufacturing overall. It's focused on artificial intelligence, power semiconductors, EVs. What are your thoughts on that in terms of the upgrading of the overall industry? The overall upgrading of the second industry here in Changsha. I mean, yes, it's a sustainable city. It's got a great mindset in terms of people wanting to enjoy life, but it's also a very important industrial city in China as well.
Sure. I think the leading industry in old time actually is more about traditional manufacturing, like the
construction machinery
and also advanced materials.
Yeah.
So, artificial intelligence is more new industry just emerging in recent years. I think one good reason behind is general development of the whole China economy to pay much attention to the digital economy. So that's quite important, the driving force behind it. And this is the general background. The second most important factor, I believe, is the local talents. Because, you know, in the Changsha city, we have more than city only, we have more than, I think it's more than 50 universities and colleges.
Wow.
So I have actually relatively cheap and high educated talents and labels from local market. I think it's great beneficial for those kind of industry they want to start up.
Yeah.
And again, back to the low property market. So in both sides, for the labor side, also for the company side, it's cheap. The running and operating cost.
Okay.
So this is generally, I believe, a general driving force is behind. Yeah.
Are you seeing perhaps the digital transformation of the manufacturing industry here in Changsha? Because it's so important to the city. It's been important to the city's development. Are you seeing technology being put more and more and more into the manufacturing sector here? Because I'm thinking the next question I want to ask you is perhaps make a pitch to foreign investors in terms of why they should choose Changsha. Because Wuhan is right there, Chengdu, Chongqing is right there, Greater Bay Area is right there.
Yeah.
Why should they choose Changsha to perhaps invest in?
Yeah, I work in the university, so I'm more active engaged in a research project in university. So at the research project level, the two most important the project we are engaging actually strongly linked with the digital economy.
Yeah.
The first one actually is using the digital technology to manage the environmental and the resources.
Fantastic.
Because this is such an important, particularly environmental issue and also resources, 有色金属, the metal resources issue, pollution and control extremely important.
Yeah.
But the technology inside is actually quite traditional. So we're trying to transfer, digital transfer those kind of the manual skill to make the to modernize our central government, the governance capacity and the control capacity.
Yeah.
This is the first thing. The second thing, I think, is related with the Xiangya Hospital.
Yeah.
I know in the Xiangya Hospital has paid much attention to the digital transformation of health care.
Oh,
so health industry,
okay.
Yeah. 大数据医疗,
yeah,
我们叫大数据医疗.
Yeah. Big data healthcare.
Yeah, so Xiangya Hospital has already committed a large amount of research fund into that project, trying to transfer that. And we already use a number of APP, which is related with that. And I see a lot of change. I think maybe Lina is in better position to tell you.
Yeah, talk to us about
health
tech.
Yeah.
And then Peter wanted to jump in as well. Yeah. We're going to get to you in a second, Peter. But in terms of health tech overall.
Yes, the biggest piece is a very development, the program for the medicine. So in our ICU, we have a lot of the data database, because the patient needed to monitor every minute.
Yeah.
We can have the EEG, respiratory rate, and sometimes the mechanical ventilator, and also from sometimes the CRT or the ECMO, it just to support the patient the oxygen and to make it living. But how about this database to be assessors? And we want to know, so how can I to confounding that the two or three the diameter to together and to help us to find that the patient maybe have the shock, maybe have the respiratory failure, maybe have the other disease. So if we can prevent it in the before that he had to development, that maybe the medicine, the effort may be good. So so for this the data place, we need to assess it, but it's not our major. So we can together with others to be collaboration and to help us to such as the APP to pay the patient and to see. And you can to tell us and I will go there and to separate it in time.
So perhaps that's what Changsha is focusing on, using technology to focus more on the preventative aspect. So preventing more focus instead of just treatment, because prevention is the best treatment. Peter, you wanted to jump in when Professor Wei was speaking.
What was I going to say? I was going to say, within the past year, I went to SANI, their headquarters. There's a Zoom Lion. There's a Bosch. And just to Anpai Houdun or whatever. And as soon as you walk in, like, it just, everything screams modern age, new era. So I was going to mention something about attracting new new people from outside. I think if you go to their headquarters, they make an extremely good impression as far as we are in this age and we're taking advantage of this era and moving forward. So I think it's not just a trend for these three huge companies, but I mean, I think it's a trend for all of the different companies in Changsha. So it could have been just a coincidence that I went to Zoom Lion, Bosch, and SANI, and then their headquarters are just like, wow, this is the future. But I think it's more than just those three companies. It's gotta be a trend for all these manufacturing and industrial sector.
SANI and Zoom Lion, both heavy industry construction machinery companies for our audiences around the world. Bosch, of course, a German engineering company. And we were talking before in terms of the Changsha spirit is what? Daring to lead, daring to be first. Right, so perhaps that comes into the business environment as well. I want to get to the entertainment industry because that's also very strong here in Changsha in terms of like Hunan Weishi, Hunan TV as well. Mango TV, just a plug for our viewers, we have an interview with Mango TV as well. So perhaps talk to us about why are there so many influencers here in Changsha. There's a lot of influencers, I think, in this city that are nationally renowned. What do you think, Yuyi? Why are there so many influencers? I guess food is going to be a big part of that. The nightlife, the entertainment.
The answer for everything is food.
Is food. That's the answer to everything. I think that's you know the final conclusion of this city is great food. What do you think?
I think maybe innovation and building Changsha as the most livable city are the most important two drivers of Changsha in the future. Because we know Changsha has become a popular city by the developing of international great economy, and especially its distinctive cultural tourism industry through the internet. And the international great economy has brought huge purchasing power. And however,
internet celebrities in terms of e-commerce.
If we only based on the internet celebrity economy, the development will not last long. Once people lose their feeling of freshness, we cannot guarantee that Changsha's tourism revenue will remain at a high level.
So
to make the influence of internet celebrity sustainable, we should make to make the innovation and the creativity to last long.
Is Changsha an innovation-driven city, you think, Professor Wei? It's becoming more and more innovation.
More innovation.
Yeah. I think last kind of the rating system is called the City Innovation Capacity. It's a kind of a national ranking.
Yeah.
And the Changsha certainly is top 10. Within my knowledge, it's top 10. Yeah.
This is why we need to come to different parts of China, because outside of the largest and most renowned cities in China, there are really these gems dotted all across the country.
Yeah.
Again, that should be on the radar of investors all around the world.
Is Changsha not on the radar?
In terms of international companies actually basing here,
internationalization. Less space, less gap here. Yeah.
Because I would assume the Chengdu Chongqing economic circle is right there. So if you want to be based in perhaps central China or southwest China, a lot of international companies may be based there, right? Or a lot of international companies may be based in the greater Bay Area. That's all very close to Changsha. And perhaps I want to get your thoughts on this as well. I mean, are you ready to compete with these big economic clusters and to get more international companies in here? What do you think, Professor Wei?
In my view, I think that definitely the gap in the level of internationalization in the city level. So we do need to improve this. And the internationalization, actually, I mean, improve it in many ways. I mean, in big ways, it has to be have a very kind of, let's say, easy English load signs, has to make it available everywhere.
It's actually pretty convenient when it comes to English road signs, in my opinion. Like, when I went to Orange Island, it was quite convenient, in my view.
What do you think? Yeah.
In terms of what?
In terms of, like, in terms English, of lo- English road signs.
English road signs?
Oh,
because
English
road signs. You're not a Chinese, maybe it's not easy for you.
No, to be honest, like, the closer you get to the city center, the more English
it's easier,
there is.
Like, the more touristy spots, definitely.
Because I drive an hour away for my half-time job during the week. And when you get out of the city, like, the English is not so present on the roadsides, or really in a lot of spaces, but when you come back to the city center, of course, is more, definitely more international feeling to it,
So that's why, I mean, from my experience or from what I can see, I do want to see the Changsha is hosting more international conferences.
Forums. Got it, yeah.
And also from Central South University, from what I can see, is we have closer to 2,000 foreign students, but actually most of students come from very limited number of countries. The background of students is still quite, it's not diverse, it's very limited.
So we
do need to promote the city in a more international level. So,
For example, like when I was doing my MBA classes, I was the only American in my class.
You are the only one, I guess.
I mean, that's why we're having these conversations, right? To really put Changsha on the roadmap.
I'm an MBA student.
Yeah.
When I was doing my MBA there, like, I think I was the only American.
I believe so.
In the whole program.
Knowledge, in the past 10 years, I think at my school only two from America. So you are waffling, I guess.
Yeah, I know the other guy.
So you guys need to speak to your admissions department, your marketing department, in terms of getting more international students in. But Peter, so from a, I wouldn't say foreign perspective, but from like an overseas international community perspective, how do you think Changsha can better boost its international image? Because it's a very important city in China already.
Right. Yeah. Absolutely. How can it boost its international
image? Yeah, international image, international influence. What do you think?
To foreign students?
To the global community.
General.
To really
global
put Changsha on
level,
that's,
because
that's a difficult question.
It's difficult, but this city has been here for 3,000 years.
Sure.
Right, Professor Wei, you were telling me this city has not changed its name for 3,000 years, which is an amazing feat. So it should be more on the international radar of the world. What do you think from an American perspective, I guess, or from a global perspective?
I'm going to hand this back off to someone else. No comment.
No.
That's a really difficult question, to be honest.
Okay.
Yeah.
Professor Wei, Dr. John, we're running out of time, right? So we got to wrap up. But any thoughts in terms of how we can really boost Changsha's influence in the world a little bit more?
Just like the Yuelu academic, it is very famous. It's the top three of the Chinese academic.
In terms of culture, is one way.
I think it's a long time ago. It's a place that many the other people coming here to have the conference. I want to know, so in your opinion, what you think is the main difference between your study in the American and in the Central South University? What is the main difference you think?
The main difference is basically just living, taking classes. Well, I'm sorry, there's many main differences.
Many main differences.
Well, firstly, I had to take my classes in Chinese.
Wow.
Yeah, okay. My MBA classes in Chinese. The other difference is that just the atmosphere, the learning atmosphere. Another difference is the 教学, like the
curriculum,
Yeah. Right, the curriculum. Also, at Central South University, or I should say in many universities in China, there's a lot of students in one classroom. They're like lecture halls. Also, each class is, you don't really get the interaction that you would maybe in an American college classroom. For example, if I wanted to have an in-depth conversation in class with my professor in America, I could probably do that. And the professor would be like, yeah, okay, let's talk about this. And that way all the other students could hear, we could bounce ideas off each other. However, in China, it's like the curriculum is more like, okay, you can talk to me after class, and let's finish what we're here to finish. So that's a big difference in the kind of 教学, or the 课程, I should say. Well, the other part is living standards of dormitories and stuff like that.
So you think what's the gap between we need to improve the teaching method?
I would say to attract more international students, I would definitely say one aspect is the living condition. Although I was treated very, very nicely. I would say not just the scholarship, but of course, more scholarship money that you get for being a student, the more attractive it is to go to that college, of course. However, I would say more focus on the of a career, of a student's potential career. I didn't really get too much help in saying, okay, we're going to help you find a job in after you get your MBA. I didn't really get that kind of focus. Maybe that was my own personal effort. For example, in America, there's a large emphasis on saying, okay, there's a lot of options for you to do after you get your degree. Let me give you some options. Let's talk about your future. Do you know what I mean?
I see.
So a more, let's say, stable or secure future for international students.
I see.
Especially if Changsha wants to keep this international feeling towards it.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's a work in progress. It's a work in progress. And Professor Wei, would you accept those points? Or
sure, I think it's a very good point. We certainly improve on that. Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe we focus on the domestic students quite low, but not on international one. But you definitely tell me the gap here. So great. It's great.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, I think Changsha is getting more and more international by the day.
It is.
The city is moving towards that area. It wants to attract more global Fortune 500 companies here. And the competition is certainly tough with all the various other economic circles around Changsha. But again, in terms of the ease of doing business, the business environment overall, in terms of regional integration, I mean, Changsha wants to see more integration with its two neighboring cities as well, Xiangtan and Zhuzhou. So we have a little economic cluster here as well. The convenience, the transportation, the food, the affordability, all of those things put together, I think makes Changsha very attractive. A package and a very attractive city to live in, and you got to come here to experience the city yourself to really understand it, right? I mean, we can sit here and talk all day, but you got to come here to experience here in Yuelu Academy such wonderful scholarly atmosphere, the green living spaces of the city, the hustle and bustle, the dynamism. Yeah, what did you want to say?
I just thought of something.
Yeah.
So 7 years ago, there weren't too many foreigners here. Like all of the foreigners that were in Changsha, like I was friends with, including ones like that were not students or just English teachers, but also including workers from Bosch or international people, international employees that were working in Changsha.
Yeah.
What I wanted to say is 7 years ago compared to today, there weren't so many international options for cuisine, for food.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
So if a foreigner wanted to go get a burger or pizza, it was very difficult to find a real burger.
Yeah.
A real Western pizza.
Yeah.
Or Italian pizza or pasta. But now more and more options are available. So I wanted to make a comment about Changsha becoming more international.
Yeah.
If I want to go get a nice steak, like a real nice Australian steak, I know exactly where to go. If I want to get a big, nice burger, I know exactly where to go. And foreigners all are definitely integrating with each other. So if a new foreigner comes and they're like, oh, where can I get a burger? And then we can just say in a WeChat group, here's the perfect place for you to get a burger. And the options are definitely becoming more international cuisine.
Yeah.
So, and also things to do for foreigners too.
Yeah.
Sure.
I mean, it is lunchtime. So unfortunately, we are out of time and we're going to have to wrap up our conversation. And perhaps I can get your advice, Peter, on where to get a good burger afterwards. But
sure.
I mean, I would say, look, we want Changsha to become more international, more connected to the world, which it already is already, you know, connected to Europe, the China-Europe Express Railway. I mean, this is a very important inland port, Changsha, but it's definitely getting more international. But what I would also say is Changsha needs to keep its traditional charm as well, right? So really have that nice balance between becoming more and more international, but also having that traditional Chinese culture, traditional Changsha culture here also. So fantastic conversation, guys. I learned a lot from all of you, being from the northeast of China and growing up outside of China as well. So a great panel, great conversation. I wish we could continue our conversation, but I think we got to get some lunch first, and I can't wait to experience the nightlife myself as well here in Changsha with my colleagues. So thank you to all of you, Professor Wei, to Peter, to Dr. Zhang, to Yi. I'm Michael Wong. We're here at the Yuelu Academy in Changsha. I got to go and enjoy the city a little bit more, so I'll see you guys later in our next Rising Star City special series. Bye for now. I think we're done, but so...